Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining us at our reading tonight. This is the final week of Bracebeard's Theatre's online reading festival, celebrating the other history plays of Shakespeare's era. We're very excited this week to be welcoming guest artists for our final two readings. And hey, everybody. Thank you for tonight's reading. Tonight's reading will be brought to you from Fireside Shakespeare Company, from my graduate school alma mater, Mary Baldwin University. So if you'd all like to come on screen and introduce yourself and tell our audience a little bit about your company and yourself.
Hi, so to start us off, my name is Rosemary ARMATO, and I co-directed this staged reading with Sarah Duttlinger, who you will see in a second. And we are coming to you as a company from Mary Baldwin Shakespeare and Performance Program, which is based in Stanton, Virginia. We are the Fireside Shakespeare Company as a collective, and we are joined by two members from the year below us, so from the second years, and we are very thankful for their help. This is our first company performance tonight, so thank you for joining us. And without any further ado, who is next, Millie?
Hi, I am Millie Konselik. Tonight I am going to be playing Lord Marquis Dorset, Prince Richard, Duke of York, Citizen, and Lord Lovell.
And hello, I'm Amy Polito, and I will be playing the Ghost, Edward the Fourth, Sir Richard Hott, and Paige.
Hello, my name is Amber James. Tonight I'll be playing Percival, the host, Miles Forrest, and Lord Stanley.
Oh, Sarah, you're muted still.
Classic. I'm Sarah Duttlinger, and I'm also the co-director of this production with Rosemary. And this evening, I will be playing Earl Rivers, Brockenberry, and Lodwick.
Hi, everyone. I'm Amanda Rogas. Tonight, I'm going to be playing the Earl of Oxford, the Cardinal, who is the Archbishop of York, James Tyrrell, and Ursula, who's referred to as Hursley in the script.
Hi, everybody. My name is Summer England, and tonight I'll be playing the Queen, Jane Shore, the Herald, Truth, and Jack Denton.
Hi, everybody. My name is Emily Hurst, and tonight I'm going to be playing King Edward V, Morton, Lendois, and Bannister.
Hello, my name is Spencer Mayo, and I've got a short list. Today I'm playing Richard III.
Hello, my name is Carolyn Headley, and tonight I will be playing the Lord Hastings, the Duke of Buckingham, and Earl Richmond.
Hello, my name is Emma Rose Krause, and I will be playing Catesby, some men, a messenger, and the Lord Grey. Oh, and I'm also playing Will Slaughter.
Hi, I am also back again really quickly, just to say that I will also be reading in this, and I will be reading for Princess Elizabeth, Thomas Vaughan, Captain Blunt, and Truth. Poetry. I'm reading for poetry.
Wonderful. All right, we're now going to turn it over to Emily MacLeod, our dramaturg for tonight's reading. Emily?
Thank you, Charlene. Hi, everyone. My name is Emily MacLeod, and I am a PhD candidate in English at George Washington University and a dramaturg for Brave Spirits Theater and their Shakespeare's Histories project. So in this Brave Spirits online readings festival, where we have been producing an 8-play cycle of other history plays, ones not often included in the popular canon of early modern drama, we have included 3 plays the troublesome reign of King John, the famous victories of Henry V, and tonight's performance, the true tragedy of Richard III, that were produced by a company called the Queen's Men. According to Scott McMillan and Sally Beth McLean, the Queen's Men were most well known for touring in the 1590s and spreading Tudor and Protestant propaganda to the English provinces, unlike companies like Shakespeare's company, the Lord Chamberlain's Men, who were primarily based on the outskirts of London. The Queen's Men are also significant to scholars of early modern drama today, because these three plays, King John, Famous Victories, and True Tragedy, all have Shakespearean counterparts. And we can guess that they served as sources for Shakespeare when he sat down to write his versions. Scholars even wonder, due to Shakespeare's familiarity with the company's repertory, which also includes a version of King Lear, if the playwright's career began with them. We can't be certain of Shakespeare's relationship to the Queen's Men, but as you watch tonight's reading, you will undoubtedly be reminded of moments from his more famous play. Of all Shakespeare's history plays, Richard III is certainly the most produced and most familiar to modern audiences. There have been two major films starring huge celebrities like Laurence Olivier and Ian McKellen. Something about this purportedly hunchbacked tyrant ordering his nephews to be murdered and calling for his horse has captured audiences' attention for centuries, and especially recently when his skeleton was found underneath a car park in Leicester in 2012. Shakespeare was not the first one to set Richard's story down, and he drew heavily from sources like Thomas More's History of King Richard III, as well as the Chronicles of Hall and Holinshed. The True Tragedy of Richard III, published in 1594 without an author, draws on these same sources, but presents itself as what Brian Walsh calls an almost photonegative version of Shakespeare's play. The True Tragedy shows us in action events that Shakespeare only describes, and describes events that Shakespeare's play shows us in action. It shows us the horrible murder of the princes in the tower, but doesn't show us Clarence's drowning in the wine barrel. It leaves out Queen Margaret, the last lingering character of the War of the Roses conflict, and instead shows us female characters like Princess Elizabeth, the daughter of Edward, and Jane Shore, Edward's mistress, who we saw heavily featured in last week's reading of Heywood's Edward IV. The only printed text of the play survives in what is known as a bad quarto. The most famous bad quarto is of Hamlet, where Hamlet finishes the line, "to be or not to be," not with "that is the question," but "aye, there's the point." Play texts, especially when they were popular, circulated in different versions based on how they got to the printing press, through authorial manuscript, playhouse prompt copy, or through a more circumspect route of oral transmission or memorial reconstruction. The text of the True Tragedy shows evidence of being the latter, a somewhat hasty effort based on its large amount of imperfect verse set as prose, as well as some of the spelling. The imperfect textual basis corresponds with anxieties in the play itself about the importance of truth in the retelling of history and who shapes the stories that get retold. The play brands itself in the very title as the True Tragedy, and one of the first figures we hear speak is an allegorical character named Truth. This induction, or short introductory scene, between the figures of truth and poetry serves as a framing device. While at first Truth tries to dismiss poetry in order for her to more effectively tell her story, the scene ends with Truth asking poetry to wend away with her and they leave together. Poetry and truth then become intertwined as the drama needs both to represent the events of 100 years previous. This framing of the action then returns at the end with an epilogue that spans that 100 years and recounts the history of the monarchs between the victorious Henry VII and Elizabeth I, the current queen and this company's patron. By beginning and ending the play in this manner, with explicit references to chronicle sources and current events, the company shows an awareness of its responsibility as purveyors of historical knowledge. But even within this call for truth and accuracy, the play features characters like Richard's page, who seem to be spinning the story in Richard's favor from the very beginning, writing and rewriting the record as we go, until we cannot trust any true report from him. It is such a pleasure to share this seldom seen work of early modern drama with you. And so, without further ado, the true tragedy of Richard the Third.
Presse cruer sanguinis, satiator sanguine cresse, quo spiro scicito, o scicito, scicito, venditia.
Truth, well met.
Thanks, poetry.
What makes thou upon a stage?
There will I add bodies to the shadows. Therefore depart and give truth leave to show her pageant.
Whereof?
Mary, thus. Richard Plantagenet of the House of York, claiming the crown by wars, not by descent, by act of parliament entailed to him the crown and titles to that dignity. He made wars upon King Henry, then the sixth, and by outrage suppressed that virtuous king, and won the crown of England to himself. But since at Wakefield in a battle pitched, outrageous Richard breathed his last breath, leaving behind three branches of that line, three sons. The first was Edward, now the king, George of Clarence, and Richard, Gloucester's duke. Then Henry, claiming after his decease his crown and former dignity, was quite suppressed, till this Edward the Fourth.
But tell me truth of Henry, what ensued?
Imprisoned he in the Tower of London lies, since cruelly murdered by Richard, Gloucester's duke.
Whose ghost was that did appear to us?
It was the ghost of George the Duke of Clarence, who was imprisoned in the Tower most unnaturally, by Gloucester, his own brother, drowned in a butt of wine.
What manner of man was this Richard, Duke of Gloucester?
A man ill-shaped, crooked-backed, lame-armed withal, valiantly minded, tyrannous in authority. So, during the minority of the young prince, he is made Lord Protector over the realm. Gentles suppose that Edward now hath reigned full 22 years, and now like to die, hath summoned all his nobles to the court to swear allegiance with the duke, his brother, leaving behind 2 sons of tender age, 5 daughters to the hapless queen, all under the protection of the Duke of Gloucester. Thus, gentles excuse the length by the matter. And here begins truth's pageant. Poetry, wind with me.
Welcome, you peers of England, unto your king.
For our unthankfulness, the heavens have thrown thee down.
I fear for our ingratitude, our angry God doth frown.
Why, nobles, he that lay me here can raise me at his pleasure. But, my dear friends and kinsmen, in what estate I now lie, it is seen to you all. And I feel myself near the dreadful stroke of death. And the cause that I have requested you in friendly wise to meet together is this, that in my lifetime I could never get any league of amity betwixt you, yet at my death let me entreat you to embrace each other, for leaving behind me my young son, your lawful king, after my decease, may be by your wise and grave counsel so governed, which no doubt may bring comfort to his famous realm of England. But what saith Lord Marquis and Lord Hastings? What? Not one word? Nay, then I see it will not be, for they are resolute in their ambition.
Ah, yield, Lord Hastings, and you, Lord Marquis, submit yourself. Consider, you are son to my mother, the queen. and therefore let me entreat you to mitigate your wrath, and in friendly sort embrace each other.
Nay, cease thy speech, Elizabeth. It is but folly to speak to them, for they are resolute in their ambitious minds. Therefore, Elizabeth, I feel myself at the last instant of death, and now must die being thus tormented in mind.
May it be that thou, Lord Marcus, that neither by entreaty of the prince, nor courteous word of Elizabeth, his daughter, may withdraw thy ambition from me?
May it be that thou, Lord Hastings, canst not perceive the mark his grace aims at.
No, I am resolute, except thou submit.
For shame, I say. Depart from my presence and leave me to myself, for these words strike a second dying to my soul. And so depart and trouble me no more.
With shame, and like your majesty, I submit therefore, craving humble pardon on my knees.
Oh, thanks, Lord Hastings.
Yield, Lord Marquis, sith Lord Hastings is contented to be united.
My gracious lord, I am content, and humbly crave your grace's pardon on my knee for my foul offense.
Now let me see you friendly give one another your hands.
With a good will, and like your grace. Therefore, Lord Marquis, take here my hand, which once was vowed and sworn to be thy death.
Well, Lord Hastings, not in show but in deed. Take thou here my hand, which was once vowed to have shivered thy body in piecemeals, but now upon allegiance to my prince, I vow perfect love and true friendship forever.
Now, my lords, for your young king that lieth now at Ludlow, attended with Earl Rivers, Lord Grey, his two uncles, and the rest of the queen's kindred, I hope you will be unto him as you have been to me. His years are but young, 13 at most, unto whose government I commit it to my brother the protector. But to thee, Elizabeth, my daughter, I leave thee in a world of trouble, and especially I give thee this in charge upon and at my death. Be loyal to thy brother during his authority, as thyself art virtuous, let thy prayers be modest, and thus leaving thee with the kiss, I take my last farewell. For I am so sleepy that I must now make an end. And here, before you all, I commit my soul to Almighty God, he that made me save me, unto whose hands I commit my spirit.
Fortune, wherefore wert thou called Fortune, but that thou art fortunate? Those whom thou favorest be famous, and Fortune, I would thou hadst never favored me.
My mistress, if you exclaim against Fortune, you condemn yourself, for who hath advanced you but Fortune?
I, as she advanced me, so may she throw me down. But Ursula, dost not hear the king is sick?
Yes, mistress, but never heard you that every sick man died.
Oh, Ursula, my mind presages some great mishaps unto me, for last time I saw the king, methought ghastly death approached his face. For what was it his grace would deny, Shore's wife? Of anything, yea, were it half his revenues, I know his grace would not see me want. And if his grace should die, I have left me nothing now to comfort me withal. And then those that are my foes will triumph at my fall. But here comes Lodwick, servant to Lord Hastings. How now, Lodwick, what news?
Mistress Shore, my lord would request you to come speak with him.
I will, Lodwick, but tell me what news. Is the king recovered?
Aye, Mistress Shore. He hath long recovered that he long looked for.
Lodwick, how long is it since he began to mend?
Even when the greatest of his torments left him.
But are the nobles agreed to the contentment of the prince?
The nobles and peers are as agreed as the king would wish them.
Thou revivest me.
Aye, but few thought the agreement and his life would have ended together.
His life? What, Ludwig, is he dead?
In brief, Mistress Shore, he hath changed his life.
His life? Ah, me. Unhappy woman. Now is misery at hand. Oh, sweet Edward, farewell, my gracious lord and sovereign. For now shall Shore's wife be a mirror and looking glass to all her enemies. Thus shall I find Lodwick, and have cause to say that all men are unconstant.
Why, Mistress Shore, for the loss of one friend, will you abandon all that wish you well?
Lodwick, I must. But say, who hath the king made protector during the minority of the young prince?
He hath made his brother, Duke of Gloucester, protector.
Ah, me. Then comes my ruin and decay, for he could never abide me to the death. No, he always hated me, whom his brother loved so well. Thus must I lament and say, all the world is inconstant.
But, Mistress Shore, comfort yourself, and think well of my lord, not within legal age to reign, who hath always been a helper unto you.
Indeed, Lodwick, to condemn his honor I cannot, for he hath always been my good lord. For as the world is fickle, so changeth the minds of men.
Oh, Master Morton, you are very welcome met. I hope you think on me for my money.
I pray, sir, bear with me, and you shall have it, with thanks to.
Nay, I pray, sir, let me have my money, for I have had thanks and too much more than I looked for.
In faith, sir, you shall have it, but you must bear with me a little. But, sir, I marvel how you can be so greedy for your money when you see, sir, we are so uncertain of our own.
How so uncertain of mine own? Why, dost thou know anybody will come to rob me?
Why, no.
Wilt thou come in the night and cut my throat?
No.
Wilt thou and the rest of thy companions come and set my house on fire?
Why, no, I tell thee.
Why, how should I then be uncertain of mine own?
Why, sir, by reason the king is dead.
Oh, sir, is the king dead? I hope he hath given you no quittance for my debt.
No, sir, but I pray you stay a while, and you shall have it as soon as I can.
Well, I must be content where nothing is to be had. The king loseth his right, they say.
But who is this?
Marry, sir, it is Mistress Shore, to whom I am more beholding to for my sentence than the dearest friend that ever I had. How now, Mistress Shore? How fare you?
Well, Morton, but not so well as thou hast known me.
God forfend, Mistress Shore, and be happy that sun shall shine upon thee.
I am glad of it, but come, Master Lodwick, shall we go? And you, Morton, you'll bear us company.
Ah, young prince, the king. And why not I? Shall law bridle nature, or authority hinder inheritance? No. I say no. Principality brooks no equality, much less superiority. And the title of a king is next under the degree of a god. For if he be worthy to be called valiant, that in his life wins honor, and by his sword wins riches, why now I, with renown of a soldier, I reaped not the gain, but the glory to be baser than a king I disdain, and to be more than a protector the law deny. Why, my father got the crown, my brother won the crown, and I will wear the crown. Or I'll make them hop without their crowns that denies me. Have I removed such logs out of my sight as my brother Clarence and King Henry VI to suffer a child to shadow me? Nay, more, my nephew to disinherit me? No, death nor hell shall not withhold me. But as I rule, I will reign. Why, what are babes but a puff of gunpowder? A mark for the soldiers, food for fishes, or lining for beds, devices enough to make them away. Wherein I am resolute in determining, need no counsel. Ho, who's within?
May it please your majesty.
Ha! Villain, majesty.
I speak but upon that which shall be, my good lord.
Well, what's he with thee?
A messenger with a letter from the Right Honorable, the Duke of Buckingham.
Yeah? Give me place. This title of majesty animates me to my purpose. Doth fortune so much favor my happiness that I no sooner devise, but she sets a broach? Or doth she but to try me, that raising me aloft, my fall may be the greater? Be as be may, I will never fear colors nor regard ruth. Valor brings me fame, and fame conquers death. Percival!
My lord.
Thy trust to thy lord is a sufficient warrant that I utter my mind fully unto thee. And seeing thy lord and I have long been foes, and have found now so fit opportunity to join league, tell him thus as a friend, I do accept of his grace, and will be as ready to put in practice to the uttermost of my power whate'er he shall be to devise. But whereas he hath writ that a removing of the young prince from the queen's friends might do well, tell him thus. It is the only way to our purpose, for he shall shortly come up to London to his coronation, at which instant we will both be present, and where by the help of thy lord I will so play my part that I'll be more than I am, and not much less than I look for. But judge thou what it is, Percival.
God send it, my lord. But my lord willed me to satisfy you, and to tell you by word of mouth that he hath in readiness a brave company of men.
What power hath he?
A brave band of his own.
What number?
My lord, to the number of 500 footmen, and unto him my lord Chamberlain and my lord Hastings.
Zounds! Does he trust the Lord Hastings?
Aye, my lord, as his own life. He is secret, I warrant you.
Well, Percival, this matter is weighty and must not be slipped. Therefore return this answer to thy lord, that tomorrow I will meet him. For today I cannot. Now the funeral's past, I must set a screen before the fire for fear of suspicion. Now must I so work. I climb, Percival, and so commend me to thy lord. And take thou this for thy pains.
I thank your grace. I humbly take my leave.
Why so? Now fortune make me a king. Fortune give me a kingdom. If I be but king for a year, nay, but half a year, nay, a month, a week, 3 days, one day, or half a day, nay, an hour, swoons, half an hour. Nay, sweet fortune, clap but the crown on my head. It is enough. Sirrah, who is there?
My lord.
What hearest thou about the court?
Joy, my lord, of your protectorship, for the most part. Some murmur, but my lord, they be of the baser sort.
A mighty army will sway the baser sort. Authority doth terrify. But what other news hearest thou?
This, my lord, they say the young king is coming up to his coronation, attended on by his two uncles, Earl River and Lord Grey, and the rest of the queen's kindred. It is reported, my lord, but I know not whether it be true or no, that the Duke of Buckingham is up in the marches of Wales, and with a band of men, and as they say, he aims at the crown.
Hush, a shadow without substance, and a fear without a cause. Zira? So follow me.
I see my lord is fully resolved to climb, but how he climbs, I'll leave that to your judgments. But what his fall will be, that's hard to say. But this I have noted. Since he hath had the charge of protector, how many noblemen hath fled the realm? How this gear will cotton, I know not. What do I do meddling in such matters?
Right loving uncles, and the rest of this company, my mother hath written and thinks it convenient that we dismiss our train, for fear of the town of Northampton is not able to receive us. Therefore, my lords, let me hear your opinions, for my words and her letters are all one, and besides, I myself give consent.
Then, thus may it please your grace, I will show my opinion. First, note the two houses of Lancaster and York. The league of friendship is but green betwixt them, and little cause of variance may cause it break. Therefore, I think it not requisite to discharge the company because of this. The Duke of Buckingham is up in the marks of Wales with a great power, and with him is joined the protector, for what cause I know not. Therefore, my lords, I've spoken my mind boldly, but do as your honors think is good.
Why, my Lord Rivers, wherefore is he protector but for the king's safety?
We have the prince in charge, therefore we need not care.
We have the prince, but they have the authority.
Why, take you not the Duke of Buckingham for the king's friend?
Yes, and we may misdoubt the Duke of Gloucester as a foe.
Why then, my Lord Rivers, I think it is convenient that we leave you here behind us at Northampton for conference with them, and if you hear their pretense to be good towards the king, you may in God's name make return and come with them. But if not, leave them and come to us with speed.
If it please your grace, I am content, and humbly take my leave of you all.
Farewell, good uncle. Oh, gods, if I do live my father's years, as God forbid, but I may, I will so root out this malice and envy sown among the nobility.
Worthily well spoken of your princely majesty, which no doubt showeth a king-like resolution.
But come, let us forward of our journey towards London.
We will attend upon your majesty.
Come on, mine host. What dost thou understand my tale or no?
If faith, my guest, you have amazed me already. But because I may think upon it the better, I pray you let me hear it once more.
Why then thus, I serve the right honorable, the Lord Protector.
Aye, I know that too well.
Then this is his grace's pleasure, that this night he will be lodged in thy house. Thy fare must be sumptuous, thy lodgings cleanly, his men used friendly and with great courtesy, and that he may have his lodging prepared as near Lord Rivers as may be.
Why, sir, if this be all, this is done already.
Nay, more.
Nay, sir, and you love me no more, here's too much already.
Nay, my lord's grace's pleasure is further, that when all thy guests have taken their chambers, that thou convey into my lord's hands the keys of every chamber, and what my lord's pleasure is further, thou shalt know in the morning.
How? Lock in my guests like prisoners?
Tell me whether you will do it or no.
Alas, what shall I do? If I should not do as my lord protector commands, he will chop off my head. But is there no remedy?
Come, sir, be brief. There is no remedy. Therefore, be brief and tell me straight.
Why? Then, sir, here's my hand. Tell my Lord Protector I will do as he commands me. But even against my will, God is my witness.
Why then, farewell.
Farewell. Even the worst guest that ever came to my house.
Oh! Mine host, Chamberlain, where is my key? But penned up like a prisoner.
Thou wretched Earl, whose aged head imagines naught but treachery. Griefst thou that I, the Gloucester Duke, should as protector sway? Wilt thou be ringleader to wrong, and must you guide the realm?
Alas, good dukes, for aught I know, I never did offend. But am I here as a prisoner kept, imprisoned here by you? Then know, I am as true to my prince as the proudest in thy crew. Upbraid me as a traitor to your grace. No, although a prisoner, I return defiance in thy face.
My lord, lay down a cooling card, for this game goes too far. You have him. Now cut him off.
But as thou art, I leave thee here, unto the officer's custody. First, bear him to Pomfret Castle. Charge them to keep him secretly. Let it be done immediately.
And sent'st thou me to common jail? Nay, then I know thy mind. God bless these tender babes that I do leave behind. And God protect them day and night. Farewell, sweet England, and my countrymen. Earl Rivers leads the way.
So now, my Lord of Buckingham, let us hoist up sail while the wind serves. This hot beginning must have a quick dispatch. Therefore, I charge and command straightly that every highway be laid close. For if word come before us, then is our pretense betrayed, and all we have done to no effect. If any ask the cause why they may not pass, use my authority. And if he resist, shoot him through.
Lord Grey, you do discomfort the king by reason of your heaviness.
Alas, Sir Richard, how can I be merry when we have such a great charge as his grace? And we cannot hear from the Earl Rivers, which makes me think the protector and he have been at some words.
Why, good uncle, comfort yourself. No doubt my uncle Earl Rivers is well, and is coming, no doubt, with my uncle of Gloucester to meet us. Else we should have heard the contrary. If any has cause to fear, it is myself. Therefore, good uncle, comfort yourself and be not sad.
The sweet joys of such a grape would comfort a man were he half dead.
Lord Grey, we hear now by all likelihoods the protector not to be far. Therefore, we are to entertain him and the Duke of Buckingham with courtesy.
Sir Richard, I shall hardly show the protector or the Duke of Buckingham any merry countenance, considering how hardly I have been used by them both. But yet for love to my prince, I will bridle my affection, but in good time they come.
Long live my princely nephew in all happiness.
Thanks, Uncle of Gloucester, for your courtesy. Yet you have made haste, for we look not for you as of yet.
Therein I show my humble duty to your grace, whose life I wish to redouble your deceased father's days.
Thanks, good uncle.
Long live your princely majesty.
Thanks, Buckingham. But uncle, you will bear us company towards London?
For that cause we came.
What's this, my Lord Grey? This is more than needs.
My lord, I hope it be no offense.
Sir, no great offense. But inward envy will burst out. No, Lord Grey, you cannot hide your malice to us of the king's blood.
Lord,
good uncle, we know the cause of your sudden quarrel.
Marry, thus, noble nephew, the old wound of envy being rubbed by Lord Grey's venomous rashness is grown to such a venomous sore that it is incurable without a remove of dead flesh.
Lord Grey, I do so much dislike thy abuse that, were it not before the prince, I would bid thee combat. But thus, and like your grace, I arrest and attach this Lord Grey, Sir Richard Hott, and Sir Thomas Vaughan, of high treason against your grace.
Only this I add. You govern the prince without my authority, allowing me no more than the bare name of protector, which I will have in the despite of you. And therefore, as your competitor, Earl Rivers, is already imprisoned, so shall you be. Till the time of Ford Law to take place.
But we have authority from the Mother Queen. Therefore, your arrest and attachment is not lawful.
Thy presumption condemns thee, Lord Grey. Thy arrest is lawful. Therefore, see them speedily and secretly imprisoned. And after the coronation, they shall answer it by law.
Oh, gods! And is it justice without my consent? Am I a king and bear no authority? If my near kindred be committed to prison, what remains for me? A crown? But how? So beset with sorrows that the care and grief will kill me ere I enjoy my kingdom. Since I cannot command, I will entreat. Good uncle of Gloucester, let me bail them all. If not, I will bail my Lord Grey, if I may.
Your grace undertakes you know not what. The matters are perilous, especially against the Lord Grey.
What perilous matters, considering he is a friend to us? I know my uncle will conceal no treason or dangerous secrecy from us.
Yes, secrets that are too subtle for babes. Alas, my lord, you are a child, and they use you as a child. Therefore, let not your grace fear anything by our determination. For as my authority is only under your grace, so shall my loyalty deserve hereafter the just recompense of a true subject.
Ay me, unhappy king. But come, uncle, shall we go to London to our untimely coronation?
What else, and please your majesty? Where, by the way, I will appoint trusty officers about you.
Sound trumpet in this parley. God save the king.
Richard.
May it please your grace to show your children the cause of your heaviness, that we, knowing it, may be co-partners of your sorrows?
Aye. Me, poor husbandless queen, and you, poor fatherless princes.
Good mother, expect the living and forget the dead. What though our father be dead, yet behold his children, the image of himself.
My poor princess, my mourning is for you and for your brother, who has gone up to an untimely coronation.
My mother, he is a prince, and in the hands of our two uncles, Earl Rivers and Lord Grey, who will no doubt be careful of his estate.
I know they will, but kings have mortal enemies, as well as friends that esteem and regard them. Oh, sweet children, when I am at rest, my nightly dreams are dreadful. Methinks as I lie in bed, I see the league broken which was sworn at the death of your kingly father. 'Tis this, my children, and many other causes of like importance that makes your aged mother lament as she doth.
May it please your grace?
My son, no more grace, for I am so sore disgraced that without God's grace, I fall into despair with myself. But who is this?
What art thou, and with thy ghastly looks presseth into sanctuary to affright our mother queen?
Ah, sweet prince, doth my countenance betray me? My news is doubtful and heavy.
Then utter it to us, that our mother may not hear it.
Yes, my friend, speak whate'er it may be.
Then thus may it please your grace, the young prince, coming up to his coronation, attended on by his two uncles, Earl Rivers and Lord Grey, and the rest of your kindred, was by the Duke of Buckingham and the Protector met at Stony Stratford. But in the end, the Duke of Buckingham's malice grew so great that he arrested and attached all those of your kindred of high treason.
When I fear he will butcher them all, but where is the prince, my son?
He remains at London, in the bishop's palace, in the hands of the Protector.
Ah, traitors! Will they lay hands on their prince and imprison his peers, which no doubt means well towards him? But tell me, art not thou servant to the Archbishop of York?
Yes, and it please your grace, for himself is here at hand with letters from the council, and here he comes.
Come, my lord, thou bringest the heavy news. Come, shoot thine arrow and hit this heart that is almost dead with grief already.
Whate'er my news be, have patience. The Duke of Gloucester greets your grace.
Bravo, my lord, for now you hit the mark.
The prince, your son, doth greet your grace.
Oh, happy tales it blew the arrow by. Ah, let me see the letter that he sent. Perhaps it may prolong my life a little.
How doth my brother? Is he in health, my lord?
In health, sweet prince, but longs to have thy company.
I am content, if my mother will let me go.
Oh, content or not, sweet prince, it must be so.
Hold. First, I will know what shall become of thee before I send my other son to them.
Your grace misdoubts the worst. They send for him only to have him bedfellow to the king, and there to stay and keep him company. And if your son miscarry, then let his blood be laid unto my charge.
No, you shall rather take away my life before you get my boy away from me.
If I could persuade you, 'twere best to let him go.
But for I see you counsel for the best. I am content that you shall have my son, in hope that you will send him safe to me. Here I deliver him into your hands. Farewell, my boy. Commend me to thy brother.
Mother, farewell, and farewell, sister, too. I will but see my brother and return to you.
Tears stop my speech. Come, let us go.
How now, my friend? Shall I go to my brother?
Oh, what else, sweet prince?
Why, thus by keeping company, am I become like unto those with whom I keep company. As my lord hopes to wear the crown, so I hope by that means to have preferment, but instead of the crown, the blood of the headless light upon his head, doth my lord say he hath been a long sleeper today? There are those of the court that are of another opinion, that thinks his grace lieth never long enough abed. He makes havoc of all to bring his purpose to pass. All those of the queen's kindred that were committed to Pomfret Castle, he hath caused them to be secretly put to death without judgment. The like was never seen in England. He spares none whom he but mistrusteth to be a hinderer to his proceedings. He is straight chopped up in prison. Now, there is court held today by divers of the council, which I fear me will cost the Lord Hastings and the Lord Stanley their best caps. For my lord hath willed me to get half a dozen ruffians in readiness, and when he knocks with his fist upon the board, they to rush in and to cry, treason, treason, and to lay hands upon the Lord Hastings and the Lord Stanley, which, for fear I should let slip, I will give my diligent attendance. But here comes my lord.
They say I've been a long sleeper today, but I'll be awake anon. Sirrah, are those men in readiness that I appointed you to get?
Aye, my lord, and give diligent attendance upon your grace.
Get thee thy weapons ready. Bring him away. Let this suffice. Thou, in that accursed sorceress, the mother queen hath bewitched me, with assistance of that famous strumpet of my brother's, Shore's wife. My withered arm is a sufficient testimony. Tonight, if thou canst, lay not Shore's wife with thee last night.
My lord, that she was in my house, I cannot deny, but not for any such purpose. If,
villain, feedest thou me with ifs and ands, go, fetch me a priest, make a short shrift, for by the blessed Saint Paul, I swear, I will not dine till I see the traitor's head away. Suffer him not to speak, and see him executed straight. Catesby, go you and see it presently proclaimed that the cause of his death and the rest were for conspiring by witchcraft the death of me and the Duke of Buckingham, that so they might govern the king and rule the realm. I think the proclamation be almost done.
Aye, my good lord, and finished too.
Well then, about it. Now, Sirrah, to thee, there's one more thing undone, which grieves me more than all the rest. And to say the truth, it is of more importance than all the rest.
Ah, that my lord would utter it to his page, then should I count myself a happy man if I could ease my lord of that great doubt.
I commend thy willingness, but it is too mighty and reacheth the stars. Come hither. And yet the matter's too weighty for so mean a man.
Yet, my good lord, utter it.
Why, thus it is. I would have my two nephews, the young prince and his brother, secretly murdered. 'Tis out. Wilt thou do it, or wilt thou betray me?
My lord, you shall see my forwardness herein. I am acquainted with one James Tyrrell. With him, my lord, will I so work, that soon at night you shall speak with him. For his trust, my lord, I dare be bound. Only this, a poor gentleman he is, hoping for preferment by your grace, and upon my credit, my lord, he will see it done.
Well, in this be very circumspect and sure with thy diligence. Be liberal. And now that Shore's wife's goods be confiscate, go from me to the Bishop of London, and see that she receive her open penance. Let her be turned out of prison, but so bare as a wretch that worthily hath deserved that plague. And let there be straight proclamation made by my lord, the mayor, that none shall relieve nor pity her. For as her beginning was most famous above all, so will I have her end most infamous above all. Have care now, my boy, and win thy master's heart forever.
Ah, unfortunate Shore's wife. Dishonor to the king, a shame to thy country, and the only blot of defame to all thy kindred. Why was I made fair that a king should favor me? But my friends should have preferred discipline before affection, for they know of my folly. Yea, my own husband knew of my breach of disloyalty, and yet he suffered me. By reason he knew it bootless to kick against the prick. Ah, sweet King Edward. Little didst thou think Shore's wife should have been so hardly used, being comfortless to die on the streets with hunger. I am constrained to beg, but I fear 'tis in vain, for none will pity me. Yet here comes one to whom I have done good in restoring his lands that were lost. Now will I try to see if he will give me anything. Good sir, take pity upon me and relieve me.
Indeed, 'tis pity to see so fair a face ask for alms. But tell me, hast thou no friends?
Yes, sir, I had many friends. But when my chiefest friends of all died, the rest then forsook me.
Belike then thy face was notorious, that thy friends leaving thee would let thee go to spoil for villains. But hearest thou, I prithee, tell me the truth. As I am a gentleman, I will pity thee.
Oh, Lodwick, tell thee the truth. Thy lands had been clean gone had it not been for Shore's wife. And dost thou make me so long to beg for a little?
Indeed. My lands I did have restored me by Mistress Shore, but is this she?
Aye, Lodwick, I am she. Therefore, what? I pray you bestow anything on me.
Oh, gods, what is this world? And how uncertain are riches. Is that the she that was in such credit with the king? Oh, nay, more, could command a king indeed. I cannot deny, but my lands she restored me. Oh, but shall I, by relieving her, hurt myself? No, for straight a proclamation is made that none shall succor her. Therefore, for fear I shall be seen to talk with her, I will shun her company and get me to my chamber, and there they shall set down in verse, heroical verse, the shameful end to a king's concubine, which is no doubt as wonderful as the desolation of a kingdom.
Ah, Lodwick, if thou wilt give me nothing, yet stay and talk with me. Gah. No. He shuns my company. All my friends now forsake me. In prosperity I had many, but in adversity, none. Now none will know me nor succor me. Therefore here I die for want of sustenance. Yet here comes another whom I have done good unto saving the life of his son. Well, I will try him to see if he will give me anything. Ah, good sir, relieve me and bestow something upon me.
Ah, neighbor, hedges have eyes and highways have ears. But who's a beggar woman? Ah, the streets are full of them, i'faith. But here's thou. Hast thou no friends that thou goest a-begging so?
Yes, sir, I had friends. But they are all dead, as you are.
Why, am I dead? Why, thou errant queen, what mean'st thou by that?
I mean they are dead in charity. But I pray, sir, had not you the life of your son saved in the time of King Edward the Fourth by one Shore's wife?
Yes, Mary, had I, but art thou a sprig of the same bough? For her sake I'll give thee somewhat.
Nay, then no, that I am she that saved the life of thy condemned son.
Who art thou? Shore's wife? Lie still, purse. I would not for 20 pounds had given her one farthing. The proclamation is so hard by King Richard.
Thou didst save the life of my son. If thou hadst not, another would. And for my part, I would have... Would he had been hanged 7 years ago, would have saved me a great deal of money then.
Alas! Thus am I become an open shame to the world? Here shall I die in the streets for want of sustenance. Alas, is my face so heinous that none will pity me? Yet here comes another to whom I've done good. Who is the least able to pleasure me yet? I will try him to see if he will give me anything. Good sir, relieve me and give me something.
Why? What art thou?
Brief, Morton, I am Shore's wife that have done good to all.
A fool, and ever thine own enemy. In troth, Mistress Shore, my store is but small. Yet as it is, we'll part stakes. But soft, I cannot do what I would. I am watched.
Good Morton, relieve me.
What, should I relieve my king's enemy?
Why, thou promised thou wouldst.
I tell thee I will not, and so be answered. Swoons I would with all my heart, but for yonder villain. A plague on him.
An honest fellow, I warrant him. How now, Shore's wife, will none relieve thee?
No one will relieve her that hath been good to all.
Why, 'twere pity to do thee good, but methinks she is fulsome. It stinks.
Why hang thee? If thy faults were so written in thy forehead as mine is, it would be as wrong with thee. But I prithee leave me and get thee from me.
You stay here a little longer. I'll make you a set away. And so farewell, good Mistress Shore.
Master Tyrrell, the king hath written that for one night I should deliver you the keys and put you in full possession. But, good Master Tyrrell, may I be so bold to demand a question without offense?
Else God forbid, say on whate'er it be.
Master Tyrrell, for your coming I partly know the cause. The king hath oftentimes hath sent me to have them both dispatched, because I was a servant to their father. Oh, the king, Edward the Fourth, oh, my heart would never let me do the deed.
What matters are between the king and me, I pray you leave it, and deliver me the keys.
Ah, here, with the tears I deliver you the keys, and so farewell, Master Tyrrell.
Alas, good Sir Robert, he's kind-hearted, but it must not prevail what I have promised the king. What ho, Miles Forrest?
Here, sir.
Miles Forrest, have you got those men I spake of? They must be resolute and pitiless.
I warrant you, sir, they are such pitiless villains that all London cannot match them for their villainy. One of them's named is Will Slaughter. The other is Jack Denton. Two murderous villains that are resolute.
I prithee call them in that I may see them and speak with them.
Ho, Will and Jack!
Here we are, sir. We are at hand.
These be they that I told you of.
Come hither, sirs, to make a long discourse were but folly. You may seem to be resolute in the cause that Miles Forrest hath delivered you. Therefore, you must cast away pity, and not so much as think upon favor, for the more stern you are, the more you shall please the king.
Zounds, sir, ne'er talk to us a favor. 'Tis not the first that Jack and I have gone about.
Well said, but the king's pleasure is this, that he will have no bloodshed in the deed doing. Therefore, let me hear your advices.
Why then, I think this, Master Tyrrell, that as they sit at supper, there should be two dags ready charged, and so sudden to shoot them both through.
No, I like that not so well. What sayest thou, Will? What is thy opinion?
Tush, here's more ado than needs. I pray, bring me where they are, and I'll take them by the heels and beat their brains against the wall.
Nay, I like that not, for 'tis too tyrannous.
Then hear me, Master Tyrrell. Let Will take one, and I'll take another. And by the life of Jack Denton, we'll cut both their throats.
Nay, sirs, then hear me. I will have it done in this order. When they both be abed and at rest, Miles Forrest, thou shalt bring them both up, and between the two feather beds, smother them both.
Why, this is very good. But stand aside, for here come the princes. I'll bring you word when the deed is done.
How fares my noble lord and loving brother?
A worthy brother, Richard Duke of York. My cause of sorrow is to see our uncle so digress from duty, love, and zeal, so unkindly thus to keep us up prisoners, and know no sufficient cause for it.
Why, brother, comfort yourself, for though he detain us a while, he will not keep us long, but at last he will send us to our loving mother again. So much I assure myself of. But here comes Miles Forrest! I prithee, Miles, tell my kingly brother some merry story to pass away the time, for thou seest he is melancholy.
No, Miles, tell me no merry story, but answer me to one question. What was he that walked with thee in the garden? Methought he had the keys.
Oh, my lord, it was one that was appointed by the king to be an aide to Sir Thomas Brackenbury.
Did the king... Why, Miles Forrest... Am not I king?
Oh, I would have said, my lord, your uncle, the protector.
Nay, my kingly uncle, I know he is now. But let him enjoy both crown and kingdom, so my brother and I may but enjoy our lives and liberty. But tell me, who are they whose ghastly looks does present a dying fear to my living body? I prithee tell me, Miles, what are they?
Oh, one, my lord, is called Jack Denton. The other is called Will Slaughter. But why start, your grace?
Slaughter? I pray God he come not to slaughter my brother and me. But tell me, Miles, is our lodging prepared?
Aye, my lord, if it please your brother and you to walk up.
Then come, brother, we will go to bed.
Sirs, stay you two here, and when they are asleep, I'll call you up.
Thee, Will. It grieves me to kill innocent princes. I like it not.
Why, you base slave, are you faint-hearted?
Nay, go forward. For now I'm resolute. Come, let's to it.
Oh, but Sirrah Jack, didst thou mark how the king started when he heard my name? What will he do when he feels me?
Oh, but ho, sirs, come softly, for now they are at rest. Oh, sleep, sweet princes, never wake no more, for you have seen the last light in this world.
Come, press them down. But Master Forrest, now they're dead, what shall we do with them?
Why, go and bury them at the heap of stones at the stairfoot. Well, I go and tell Master Tyrrell that the deed is done.
Well, we will. Farewell, Master Forrest.
Good, my lord, save my life!
Ah, villain, thou betrayedst me, and not for duty to thy prince. A good servant thinks his life well spent that spends it in the quarrel of his master. But, villain, make thyself ready, and Here, receive thy death.
Henry, Duke of Buckingham, I arrest thee in King Richard's name as traitor.
Well, Harold, I will obey thy rest. But am I arrested in King Richard's name, that traitor to God and man? Ah, Richard! Did I hold thee in all thy sly and wicked practices, and for my reward dost thou now allot me death? Buckingham, thou playedst thy part. Was not thy meaning good in displacing the usurper to raise a lawful king? Ah, Buckingham, it was too late. The lawful heirs were smothered in the Tower, even Edward and thy brother. I never slept easy thinking on their deaths. Thou villain, whom of a child I nursed thee up, and hast unjustly betrayed thy lord, let the curse of Buckingham ne'er depart from thee. Let vengeance, mischiefs, tortures light on thee and thine.
My lord, we are sorry, but come, lay hands on.
The goal is got, and the golden crown is won. My fearful shadow still follows me. My conscience, witness of the blood I spilt, methinks the crown, which I before did wear and chased with pearl and costly diamonds, is turned now into a fatal wreath of fiery flames and ever-burning stars. What canst thou do to purge thee of thy guilt? Repent not I. Then, Richard, be thus resolved, to pace thy soul in valance, soul for soul, and body for body. That's good. Catesby!
You called my lord, I think.
It may be so. But what think'st thou, Catesby?
Of what, my lord?
Why, of all these troubles.
Why, my lord, I hope to see them happily overcome.
How, villain? Dost thou hope to see me happily overcome?
Who? You? My lord?
Aye, villain. Thou points at me. Thou hopest to see me overcome.
No, my good lord. Your enemies, or else not.
Good, Catesby. But what hearest thou of the Duke of Buckingham?
Why, he is dead, my lord. He was executed at Salisbury yesterday.
It is impossible. His friends hope that he shall outlive me, to be my head. And since they hope he shall outlive me to be my head, he hops without his head and rests among his fellow rebels. But, Catesby, what hearest thou of Henry, Earl of Richmond? Hearest thou not he lives in Bretagne, in favor with the Duke? Nay, more, Lady Margaret, his mother, conspires against us and persuades him that he hath right to the crown. Therefore, tell me, what thinkst thou of the Earl?
I wish he were as good a friend as he is a foe, else the due deserts of a traitor.
What's that?
Why, my lord, to lose his head.
Yea, marry, I would 'twere off quickly then. But more to the strengthening of his title. She goes about to marry him to the queen's eldest daughter, Lady Elizabeth. A marriage begun in mischief shall end in blood. I think that accursed sorceress, the mother queen, doth nothing but bewitch me, and hatcheth conspiracies, and brings out perilous birds. But who comes here, Catesby? One of our spurs to revenge, the Lord Stanley, father-in-law to Lady Margaret. Now, Lord Stanley, what news? Have you received any letters of your late embassage into Bretagne?
I'm my lord, for that I have received.
And how doth your son then? Is he in health?
For his health, my lord, I do not mistrust.
Faith, tell us, when means he to arrive in England? And how many of our nobility is with him? And what power is with him?
And please your grace, his power is unknown to me, nor willingly would I be privy to such causes.
Oh, good words, Lord Stanley. But give me leave to glean out of your golden field of eloquence. Why is not his mother thy wife? and dares he pass over without the blessing of his mother, whose husband thou art?
I desire your majesty, but give me leave to speak.
Yea, speak, Stanley. No doubt some fine colored tale.
And like your grace, whereas you mistrust that I knew of my son's departure out of England into Bretagne, God, I take it to record, it was unknown to me, nor know not yet what his pretense is. Therefore, I humbly crave pardon.
Well, Stanley, I feared we proved to the contrary, that thou didst furnish him both with money and munition, which if it be, then look for no favor at my hands, but the due desert of a traitor. But let this pass. What's your repair to our presence?
Only this, my lord, that I may repair from the court to my house in the country.
Aye, sir, that you might depart the realm at your pleasure, or else to suffer an intolerable foe under me. But, Stanley, to be brief, thou shalt not go. Soft, Richard, were it better to be alone than to have noisome company? He shall go, leaving for his loyalty a sufficient pledge. Come hither, Stanley. Thou shalt go, leaving me here thy son and heir, George Stanley, for a pledge, that he may perish for thy fault if need should be. If thou likest this, go. If not, answer me briefly, and say quickly no.
I am to advise myself upon a secret cause, and of a matter that concerns me near. Say that I leave my son unto the king, that I should but aid Earl Richmond. My son George Stanley dies, but if my faith be kept unto my prince, George Stanley lives. Well, I will accept the king's proffer. And please your grace, I am content, and will leave my son to pledge. Farewell, George.
Carry George Stanley to prison. See to it, Catesby.
Alas, my lord, shall I go to prison?
Shall you go to prison? What a question's that! Now, will we look to the rest? I sent the Lord Lovell to the Mother Queen, concerning my suit to her daughter Elizabeth. But see in good time, here he is. How now, Lovell? What news? What saith the Queen Mother to my suit?
My lord, very strange she was at first, but when I had told her the cause, she gave consent.
God have mercy, Lovell. What said Lady Elizabeth?
Why, my lord, strange as women will be at the first, but through entreaty of her mother, she quickly gave consent.
Aye, Mary Lovell, let not that opportunity slip. God's wounds! Who is that? Search the villain. Has any dags about him?
No, my lord, I have none.
From whence comes thou?
From the peers at Nottingham in Scotland, and they greet your majesty.
Sirrah, is the marriage concluded between the Scottish Earl and the fair Lady Rosa?
How sayest thou? Is it concluded?
Nay, will you give me leave to tell you that? Why, you villains, we know the secrets of my letter by interrupting messengers that are sent to me. Away, I say. Away, I say. What, here yet, villains?
Well, my lord, I have somewhat to say besides.
Then speak it. What hast thou to say?
This, my lord. When the peers of England and Scotland met at Nottingham together to confer about the marriage of your niece, it was straight determined that she should be married with the Scottish Earl. And further, my lord, the council commanded me to deliver unto your grace the treasons of Captain Blunt, who had the Earl of Oxford in charge in Hames Castle. Now they are both fled, and purposeth to aid the Earl of Richmond against your grace. Now, my lord, I take my leave.
Oh, villains, rebels, fugitives, thieves! How are we betrayed when our own sword shall beat us? I will arm me with my friends and cut off my enemies, and beard them to their face that dares me. And but one, aye, one beyond the seas that troubles me. His power is weak, and we are strong. Therefore I will meet him with such melody that the singing of a bullet shall send him merrily to his longest home.
Welcome, dear friends and loving countrymen. Welcome, I say. Richard Buck usurps in my authority. Thus, courage, countrymen, and never be dismayed. Our quarrel's good, and God will help the right. For we may know by dangers we have passed that God, no doubt, will give us victory.
Here, Earl Oxford plights his faith to thee, to follow still with resolution, till thou be crowned as conqueror of the field. Then, cousin Richmond, being resolved thus, let us straight to arms, and God and St. George for us!
As this brave earl has said, so say we all.
So saith Lendois that honors Richmond so with love unfeigned for his valor past, that if your honor lead the way to death, Peter Lendois hath sworn to follow thee.
Thanks, Lendois. And here Earl Richmond's vows, if their kind promises take but effect, that as they have promised I be made king, I will so deal in governing the state that England shall in them be honored. And I will draw my sword, brave countrymen, and never leave to follow my resolve. But who's that that knocks?
My lord, 'tis a messenger from the mother queen, and the word Stanley your mother, with letters.
Admit him straight. Now we shall hear some news.
Long live Earl Richmond, the mother queen doth greet your honor.
Welcome, my friend. How fares our mother and the rest?
In health, my lord, and glad to hear of your arrival safe.
My friend, my mother hath written to me of certain that are coming in our aid, the report of whose names are referred to thee to deliver.
First, there's the Lord Talbot, the Earl of Shrewsbury's son and heir, with a brave band of his own. There's also the Lord Fitzherbert, the Earl of Pembroke's son and heir. Of the gentlemen of the Welsh, there is Sir Rhys ap Thomas, and Sir Thomas ap Richard, and Sir Owen Williams, brave gentlemen, my lord. These are as the chief.
Well, my friend, take this for thy good news, and commend me to our mother and the rest. There, my lords, you see, God still provides for us. Therefore, let us towards Atterstone amain, where we this night, God willing, will encamp. From thence, towards Lichfields, we will march next day, and nearer London, bid King Richard pay.
Where shall I find a place to sigh my fill and wail the grief of our sore troubled king? His looks are ghastly, hideous to behold, and from the privy center of his heart there come such deep-fetched sighs and fearful cries that, being with him in his chamber oft, he moves me weep and sigh for company. For if he hear one stir, he rises up and claps his hand upon his dagger straight, ready to stab him, whatsoe'er he be. But stay. What noise is this? Who have we here? How now, sir? Whither are you going so fast?
Why, to Earl Richmond's camp to serve with him.
Why, comes there any more?
A number more.
Ah, Richard. Now do my eyes witness that thy end is at hand. My master hath lifted out many, and yet hath left one to lift him out of all. Not only of his crown, but also of his life. But I will in to tell my lord of what has happened.
How fares my gracious lord and father?
In good health, my son, and the better to see thee thus forward in this laudable enterprise. I am now in few words to deliver much matter. For know this, when I came to crave leave of the king to depart from the court, the king very furiously began to charge me that I was both acquainted with thy practices and drifts, till as pledge of my loyalty and true dealing with the king, I should leave my young son, George Stanley. Thus have I left my son in the hands of a tyrant, only of purpose to come and speak with thee.
But
omitting this, I pray tell me, shall I look for your help in the battle?
Son, I cannot. For as I will not go to the usurper, no more I will not come to thee.
Why then, it is bootless for us to stay, for all we presumed upon was on your aid.
My son, see how contrary you are. For I assure you, the chiefest of his company are liker to fly to thee than to fight against thee. And note this besides, that the king is now come to Leicester and means tomorrow to bid thee battle in Bosworth.
Come, my lord, I do descry the enemy. Descry.
Son, farewell, I can stay no longer.
Yet, good father, one word more ere you depart. What number do you think the king's power to be?
Marry, some 20,000. And so farewell.
We hardly 5,000. Being beset with many enemies, hoping upon a few friends. Yet, despair not, Richmond. Remember, thou fightst in right. Therefore, Richmond, go forward. God and Saint George for me.
The hell of life that hangs upon the crown. Daily cares, the nightly dreams, horror of my bloody practice past, strikes such a terror to my wounded conscience that sleep I, wake I, or whatsoever I do, methinks their ghosts come gaping for revenge. Clarence complains and crieth for revenge. My nephew's blood's revenge, revenge doth cry. And everyone cries, let the tyrant die. The sun by day shines hotly for revenge. The moon by night eclipseth for revenge. The stars are turned to comets for revenge. The planets change their course for revenge. The screeching raven sits croaking for revenge. Whole heads of beasts come bellowing for revenge. And all, yea, all the world, I think, cries for revenge and nothing but revenge. But to conclude, I have deserved revenge. In company, I dare not trust my friend. Being alone, I dread the secret foe. I doubt my food, lest poison lurk therein. Than such a life I count far worse to be than 1,000 deaths unto a damned death. The bad rebellion of my foe is not so much as for to see my friends do fly in flocks from me.
May it please your grace to rest yourself content, for you have power enough to defend your land.
My friends are gone away and fled from me. Keep silence, villain, lest I by post do send thy soul to hell. Not one more word if thou dost love thy life.
My lord.
Yet again, villain! Hates me. Is it thou? What, comes the Lord Stanley or no?
My lord, he answers no.
Why, didst not tell him then I would send his son, George Stanley's head, to him?
My lord, I did so, and he answered he had another son left to make Lord Stanley.
Villain, vile. Fetch George Stanley forth. Him, with these hands, I will butcher for the dead and send his headless body to his sire.
Leave off executions now. The foe is here, and that threatens us most cruelly of our lives.
Zounds! Foe me no foes! The father's fact condemns the son to die.
But guiltless blood will for revengement cry.
The bond is broken. I will sue the fine. Except you will hinder me. What, will you have it so?
In doing true justice, else we answer no.
Zounds! Draw you cuts who shall go. I bid you, Catesby. Level, Catesby, let's join lovingly and devoutly together, and I will divide my whole kingdom amongst you.
We will, my lord.
We will, my lord.
Catesby, thou lookest like a dog, and thou, Level, too. You will run away with him that be gone, and the devil go with you all. God, I hope. God. What talk I of God that has served the devil all this while? I hope, with this lame hand of mine, to rake out that hateful heart of Richmond. And when I have it, to eat it, panting hot with salt, and drink his blood lukewarm, though I be sure 'twill poison me. Sirs, you that be resolute, follow me. The rest, go hang yourselves. A horse, a fresh horse.
Ah, my lord, fly and save yourself.
Fly, villain. Look I as though I would fly. No, first shall this dull and senseless ball of earth receive my body cold and void of sense. You watery heavens, roll on my gloomy day, and darksome clouds close up my cheerful sound. Down is thy sun, Richard, never to shine again. This ground must be my grave. Yet golden thoughts that reach for a crown are come as comforts to my drooping heart, and bids me keep my crown and die a king. These are my last. What more I have to say, I'll make report among the damned souls.
My friend, whate'er thou beest, tell me unto the true report, which part hath won the victory, whether the king or no.
Ah, no. The king is slain, and he hath lost the day. And Richmond, he hath won the field and triumphs like a valiant conqueror.
But where's William Catesby?
He is this day beheaded on a stage at Leicester because he took part with my lord at the king. But stay, report, and thou shalt hear me tell the brief discourse, and how the battle fell then. Know, report, that Richard came to field, mounted on horseback, with as high resolve as fierce Achilles amongst the mighty, sturdy Greeks. And then my lord displayed his colors straight, and with the charge of trumpet, drum, and fife, followed honor to the gates of death, straight spurred his horse to encounter with the Earl, in which encounter Richmond did prevail. And there was worthy Richard wounded, so that after that he ne'er recovered strength. But to be brief, my master would not yield, but with his loss of life he lost the field. Report, farewell.
Now, noble peers and worthy countrymen, since God hath given us fortune of the day, let us first give thanks unto his deity. And next, with honors fitting your desires and deserts, I must be grateful to my countrymen. Sorry I am for those that I have lost by our dangerous encountering with the foe. But sorrow cannot bring the dead to life, and therefore are my sorrows spent in vain. Only to those that live, this much I say, I will maintain them with annual pay. And, loving father, lastly to yourself, for your thanks, I hope it shall suffice that I in nature love and honor you.
Well spoken, son, and like a man of worth.
Oh, there's our lovely queen!
In health, Earl Richmond, glad to hear the news that God hath given thee fortune of the day. But tell me, lords, where is my son, Lord Marquis Dorset, that he is not here? What, did he die in this tragedy?
Oh, no, lovely queen. Your son doth live in France. Being distressed was driven by force of tempest to that shore. But, madam, now our troubled war is done, Lord Marquis Dorset shall come home again.
Richmond, gramercies for thy kind good news, which is no little comfort to thy friends, to see how God hath been thy happy guide in this late conquest of our enemies.
Then, madam, pardon me, though I make bold to charge you with the promise that you made touching the marriage of Elizabeth. And having entered what I promised you, madam, I look and hope to have my due.
But what saith fair Elizabeth to us? For now we have welcomed our other friends. I must bid you welcome, lady. And in my welcome crave to be resolved how you resolve touching my proffered love unto you.
Then know, my lord, that if my mother please, I must in duty yield to her command. For when our aged father left his life, he willed us honor still our mother's age. And therefore, as my duty doth command, I do commit myself to her dispose.
Then here, my lord, receive thy royal spouse, virtuous Elizabeth, for both the peers and commons do agree that this fair princess shall be wife to thee. And we pray all that fair Elizabeth may live and never yield to death.
And now were but my son, George Stanley, here. How happy were our present meeting then. But he is dead. But how now? What noise is this?
Behold, Lord Stanley, we bring thy son. Thy son, George Stanley, whom with great danger we have saved from fury of a tyrant's doom.
And lives George Stanley? Welcome, my son, my sweet George. Welcome home.
Thanks, my good father, and George Stanley joys to see you all joined in this assembly, and like a lamb kept by a greedy wolf within the enclosed center of the earth, expecting death without delivery, even from this danger is George Stanley come. For when the bloody butcher heard your honor did refuse to come to him, he like a savage tiger went then enraged, commanded straight I should be murdered, and sent these two to execute the deed. But they that knew how innocent I was did post him off with many long delays, alleging reasons to allay his rage, but 'twas in vain, for he like a starved lioness did still called for blood, saying that I should die. But to be brief, when both the battles joined, these two and others shifted me away.
Now, seeing that each thing turns to our content, I will it be proclaimed presently that traitorous Richard, by our command, be drawn through the streets of Leicester stark naked. Now, for our marriage and our nuptial rites, our pleasure is that they be solemnized in our Abbey of Westminster, according to the ancient custom due, the 22nd day of August next. Set forward, lords, toward London straight, there to take further order for the state.
Thus, gentles, may you here behold the joining of these houses both in one. By this, brave Prince Henry the Seventh, who was for wit compared to Solomon, his government was virtuous every way, and God did wondrously increase his store.
He did subdue a proud rebellious lord that did encounter him upon Blackheath. He died when he had reigned full 23 years, 8 months, and some odd days, and lies buried in Westminster. He died and left behind a son.
A son he left, a Harry of that name, a worthy, valiant, and victorious prince, for on the 5th year of his happy reign he entered France, and to the Frenchman's costs he won.
And lastly, in this king's decreasing age, he conquered Bellone. And after, when he was turned home, he died. When he had reigned a full 38 years, 9 months, and some odd days, and was buried at Windsor, he died and left 3 famous sprigs behind him.
Edward VI, he did restore the gospel to his light, and finished that his father left undone. A wise young prince, given greatly to his book.
He brought the English service first in use, and died when he had reigned 6 years, 5 months, and some odd days, and lieth buried in Westminster.
Next after him, a Mary did succeed, which married Philip, King of Spain. She reigned 5 years, 4 months, and some odd days, and is buried in Westminster. And she was dead. Her sister did succeed.
Worthy Elizabeth, a mirror in her age, by whose wise life and civil government her country was defended from the cruelty of famine, fire and sword, war's fearful messengers. This is that queen, as writers truly say, that God had marked down to live forever.
Then happy England, amongst thy neighbor isles, for peace and plenty still attends on thee, and all the favorable planet smiles to see thee live in such prosperity.
She is that lamp that keeps fair England's light, and through her faith her country lives in peace, and she hath her proud Antichrist put to flight and been the means that civil wars did cease.
Then, England, kneel upon thy hairy knee and thank God that still provides for thee.
'Twere vain to tell the care this queen hath had in helping those that were oppressed by war, and how her majesty hath still been glad when she hath heard of peace proclaimed from far.
Geneva, France, and Flanders hath set down the good she hath done since she came to the crown.
For which, if e'er her life be ta'en away, God grant her soul may live in heaven for aye.
For if her grace's days be brought to end, your hope is gone, on whom did peace depend?
Vinny!
Vinny!
Thank you for joining us tonight for this reading by Fireside Shakespeare Company of the true tragedy of Richard III. We are now going to have a Q&A with our team of artists. So if you have any questions, feel free to type them in the YouTube chat. I'll be watching them. And in the meantime, dramaturg Emily MacLeod will get us started.
Yes. I'd love the actors to pop up and join me here. Congratulations, you guys. That was wonderful. The question I have is pretty broad, but I think it's, you know, interesting to think about, especially for you all who are students of Shakespeare and performance of early modern texts. It's not often that you start a rehearsal process with a text that has undergone absolutely no editorial intervention of any kind other than some modernized spelling. And so maybe I will start with Rosemary and Sarah as the directors who cut this text and who kind of encountered it first. What was your all's experience, like I said, encountering this text for the first time, and what were the things that popped out at you as being particularly interesting or difficult about that?
Right, so I'll go ahead and take it away since I actually did the cutting for the script. One of the things that I first encountered, which is a small thing, but it's just an interesting thing to note that you might want to know about the script, anyone who's watching, is that as you're reading through, you have four different kings, right? So you have Edward in the beginning, then you have little boy prince, and then you have Richard, and then you have Richmond, right? So you have four different kings. And in the text, what it will do is it will just say that the king is speaking. So it won't say Edward IV, it won't say Richard, it just says king. So that was kind of disorienting when I was first reading it, because it was like, why does Richard sound like he's 10? And I was like, because he's 10. Yeah, it's because he's 10. It's because it's not Richard. That was kind of the first thing that I had to do, at least for my own sake, was to go through and switch out the names so that you could see it. Another thing about this text that really stood out to me was the addition of Jane Shore in a way that was really interesting, because you don't really get any kind of conclusion on her. She's just kind of thrown in the beginning. She's sort of tied in another scene in the end, and then she just kind of goes away. So that was an interesting plot point that didn't feel like it was really tidied up, felt like it was kind of thrown in, but I thought was one of my favorite parts of the play. I think it was really interesting. So I think those are some of the things that stood out to me as something maybe unpolished about the text, but I thought it was a joy to work with. Most of my cutting came at the end when you have Richmond talking, because you have a lot of different monologues where he's saying the same kind of like, thank you to Dad, thank you to Mom, thank you to all you guys, thank you to God, thank you to St. George. So we just took out like four of those. So and I trimmed, of course, you know, some of Richard's soliloquies. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. And I'd love to open it up to the actors. You know, when you received the script and started working on it, what were the things kind of popped out at you? Yeah. Spencer?
The biggest editorializing I did on my, I had to take our script and copy it into my own file so I wouldn't mess with everybody else's version of it. But I ended up adding in just a massive amount of punctuation. There was like no periods, no exclamation points, obviously, nothing like that. So I just changed every punctuation in the script, basically, so I could kind of get a better feel for how I was supposed to say everything.
Yeah, and Carolyn, you had a hand?
One thing I noticed about the script, first, I think it's both really interesting to not have everyone else's ideas layered over your first read of the script, because we all got to read the first script and then we read the edited bit, and it's fun to see how different people do it, how Rosemary does it is going to be different from how any other, you know, director or dramaturg would do it. But the things I noticed about this play, I definitely noticed the addition of new characters, and I noticed how much of it is told through reportage that is in a scene that seems completely, you have to look really carefully because some of the things that are reported on, like you'll have a report about Richard of Buckingham in a Jane Shore scene, which is just, you think those two things aren't connected, but they are. And so you have to look really carefully for how things are interlaced because it's not being pointed out for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Amber?
One thing that was interesting, and it was you, Emily, that figured it out, was I was playing a character, originally it was called Ostler, and it's because all you see in the text is O-S-T-E. I think you just probably figured that's a shortened version of a name. And then once we were reading it the first time, we realized, because he says my host, O-S-T-E, host, with a little bit of a Cockney British accent. But it's host. And I just thought that's so interesting. And like, there's no way to know that because of the character at the beginning of each line, the character names are shortened. And so it's things like that where it's because there's no editor that's ever looked at it, we were the ones to discover that. And it just kind of stuff like that is just really cool.
And it was through hearing it as well that gave us the answer to that kind of conundrum, which is interesting if you think about how this text was potentially transmitted to print through oral, through auditory channels. So that, you know, makes sense. Amy, did you have something to add?
Yeah, because I had the line that says, come on, mine host, and yeah. All I had was O-S-T-E, and because I'm a bad actor and only looked at who I was playing and what I was doing, didn't know that was like Ostler, and I was like, yeah, that, and then Amber was like, oh, is that how we say it? But the same thing happened with me with Sir Richard Haught, but in the script it's H-A-P-C-E, because why not?
Yeah, the spelling, it gave us a lot of, you know, tricky turns there. Yeah, Summer?
I thought it was fascinating in the script that Jane Shore in the text was referred to as Shore's wife, even though she was a mistress. And I don't know, I thought that was funny. And the way that she talks about her husband, even knowing that this was a thing, I don't know. And it was still like a possessive way to use her name in the text.
Yeah. And if you watch last week's reading of Edward IV by Heywood, which is a play that was written after this, but it gives a lot of stage time to Matthew Shore, her husband, and that relationship as well. Emma Rose?
I one of the things that I love about like these unedited versions of the early modern scripts is that you kind of have to like move around like the stage directions, like and they'll only like give you entrances, and so a lot of the times with the messenger, my entrance would be way earlier than it should be, like a monologue earlier, and then they're like, who's this? And I'm like, oh, so we had to like move the entrance for both like with the messenger and with Catsby. And then also like there would be no exit. And suddenly you'd see something that's like, oh, this is I'm definitely not here right now. I shouldn't be hearing this. And so you'd have to be like, oh, okay, where am I meant to exit?
Yeah, and the original script wasn't even broken up into scenes either. It just kind of runs continuously. You have to track who's going out, who's coming in. Charlene, is there a question from the chat we want to turn to?
Yes, we did get one question from our audience remarking on you were all playing multiple roles throughout and did so very successfully. And so your number one 7-year-old fan would like to hear you all talk about how particularly you were so good at vocal changes and sort of how you create that character differentiation and what your approaches are there.
Yeah, Amanda?
Yeah, so I love plays where I can play multiple tracks. As a character actor, I think that's exciting. And I do some dialect coaching and I'm really good with character voices. So I was really excited when I got the script to see how do these people talk? What register do they talk in? And I also explored physically sort of off screen, where in my body they were, like, are they leading with their chest? Or and how does that affect how you sit in the chair and how you're talking? And so that's a big part of my character acting that I do. And usually when I can find the voice or the tonality with where they're from, the character starts to come to life and it pieces itself together. And we did that with costuming as well. So it was just practice and piecing things together and really listening to our partner as well.
Yeah. Millie, did I see a hand? I just want to make sure people who haven't talked can get a chance to share.
Yeah, I played the young prince, and what we talked about a little bit 2 nights ago when we had a rehearsal was how old is this prince? Because the other prince, Edward, gets around about age, about 13. So we figured he has to be just a bit younger. So we kind of settled between 8 and 10. And I think that definitely helped tune the voice, and then the addition of the stuffed animal very much played a part in being very close to it.
Yeah, Rosemary?
Yeah, I was just going to comment that, on the remark about voices, is that in this Zoom kind of world, that's really one of the main tools, or really one of the only tools that we have to use right now as actors. I mean, sure, you can throw something on your upper torso, but I mean, even physicality is hard to do across this medium. I mean, you can change your shirt in the 2 minutes that you have, maybe you're wearing a different color, but we had to really lean into voices to convey different things about these characters, because that's one of the only ways that we could do that with this format.
Yeah, Emma Rose?
So one of the things that I really liked doing whenever I was differentiating my characters, especially in this platform, was how does the character take up space in the Zoom box? Catesby is much more in the center of the Zoom box and doesn't really move. But then the messenger just goes all over, and definitely Will Slaughter just is in and out of the Zoom box. And I think that how they move in and out of the Zoom box, where they keep their presence in this rectangular area that we call home right now, is really important to character differentiation as well.
Yeah, I'm gonna go Summer and then Carolyn.
Yeah, I think kind of hitting on what Emma Rose said, you can control some things in your Zoom performance, like how you are seen, how you are seated, where your orientation is. And it's something that helped me with voices was how close I am to the microphone. Like with Jane Shore, I was more intimate with Ursula and trying to get to the audience. And then Jack Denton was this murderer dude who was all over the place. But you can see yourself in this performance, which is weird, but it also helps knowing okay, I need to be more different than I am because I see how I am doing, and you kind of can hear some reverb sometimes. So it's cool. It's cool to see what you can do in a Zoom performance.
Yeah, we'll do Carolyn and then we'll go to Sarah.
All right, well, first I want to say I'm actually learning so much from everyone else's answers, and I'm going to keep them all in mind next time we do something like this. And next, I mean, one of the things I did was I just made sure that, or tried to make sure, you can tell me how well I did, that I was angling towards the camera, like a little bit differently for everyone. I had like Hastings sort of centering up here and Buckingham always at an angle looking slightly down, and Richmond would have more light. And playing with voices, given that our rehearsal process was fairly short, that mostly just happened in itself, but I deliberately actually inverted my voices for Buckingham and Richmond because I was like, why does the hero king have to have like the deep voice? Why can't he have my something closer to my voice instead? Like, it's me playing him, so it's gonna be mine.
Yeah, fair.
From a directorial standpoint, this was something I talked about with Rosemary, that directing for this little rectangle right here means that a lot of a normal director's, you know, input, you know, on the full physicality of the characters and helping the actors kind of find that, as well as, you know, sometimes for some actors it comes with a costume. They put on the jacket and suddenly the voice comes. As a director in this moment, I got to see what the actors brought to the table. They were like, I think it's a shawl. And then just sort of jumping from there. And to me, that made all of the choices extra personal, because this was like, I brought my shawl that my grandmother gave me on my couch. And there's something really tender about that, that I think made it really freeing to hear all of the different voices, so that we didn't really, obviously we had a very short time period, but we didn't have to do a lot of tweaking to voices because they were just coming naturally. We didn't have time to make a big choice. So you just made a choice and went with it, and it worked.
Yeah, that's one thing I love about the props and costumes and stuff. It's not only are the actors bringing it themselves, but it's literally like they only have access to the stuff that's in their apartment. So you can see some really fun, you know, we got some swords, we got, you know, or we have a paper crown or whatever, but it's just a really fun way to see kind of literally what you bring to the table. Yeah. Charlene, do we have another question?
Yeah, one more question, specifically for Richard, about how sympathetic you found this version of the character and how that affected your portrayal of him.
I've always felt Richard III to be sympathetic in the end of the play. I think that the mistakes that you make along the way to like the eventual demise of like whatever thing you're pursuing is something people can relate to in many ways. I think that Richard at the beginning of the play and throughout the middle, like sections of the play, absolutely not at all. I couldn't relate to him having that kind of like attempt to crawl up like the ladder to the top of the tree. I could not sympathize with that. But I absolutely at the end, I think I could feel much more for him as a character. This show in particular, he had a he felt much more brutal to me in the sense that this is what I'm doing. It was never, ooh, maybe I'll try this or maybe I'll try this. It's just, I kill the kids, I'm the king, oh no, everything fell apart. So at the end, everything falling apart, it was definitely sympathetic. So it changed how I felt about Richard reading it from a different perspective, but I still sympathize with him about the same amount as I normally do, which is not very much until the very end.
Rosemary, did you want to add something?
Yeah, sorry, if I just could comment really quickly that this Richard, one of the ways that he felt different for me, at least in the way that, you know, I was approaching the text originally from the cut, he has much more pangs of conscience. You see this Richard kind of going back and forth on the things that he's doing and wondering how it's going to impact his, you know, moral afterlife or whatever, in a way that you don't see the Richard of Shakespeare's play. And another thing that makes this Richard very different for me is you hear less of the, oh, woe is me, I have a bad back stuff, everyone hates me because I'm ugly, that's why I'm being horrible to people, kind of pity party thing. In this one, I shouldn't have said pity party maybe, but you have less of that objective behind his actions and more of a climb for power. I think, does that make sense? That it seems to be more about his ambition and his desire for the crown than it does about like the underdog trying to get back at the pretty guys, right? So this Richard just felt very different to me. And that was actually one of the things that really surprised me about this text as well.
Yeah, Amber?
One thing that I just noticed as just like watching Spencer do it is like, because one of my favorite scenes is the in Shakespeare's play is the one with Anne. And that's like one of the first scenes you kind of, it's not the first scene, but it's near the beginning of the play. That's like your first taste of Richard. And it's so manipulative. And like, it's not, it's about his goals, but it's not about like that. This one is much more direct. The action is like, he's, you know, it's, he's getting up to the throne. And that one, it's, that scene is so long. And yeah, so I just like, it's just so interesting that like, because that kind of stuff is not in this play, how different that just makes him appear to me as an audience member.
Yeah, that's a huge difference. The omission of Lady Anne and that whole scene where, the audience really gets this full on performance of like what Richard is capable of. Yeah. Emma Rose?
This Richard is also kind of different, like because like we see the majority of the script, he doesn't really have his wits about him. Like he's slowly getting crazier and crazier in each of his scenes because he's not sleeping in a way that you see more control of Shakespeare's Richard over himself for more of the play. Like it definitely there are some sleepless nights going on in that play, but this Richard, like it really early on, he's just starting to lose it.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much. Is that a good place to wrap up for tonight?
Yeah, I think that is. So thank you to all of you from Fireside Shakespeare Company for that thoroughly entertaining reading and the very thoughtful Q&A as well. I did want to take a moment for one last thing from me before we wrap up for the night. Across the country right now, Americans are being attacked and arrested for exercising their right to protest. And the right to gather and have our voices heard is meant to be a hallmark of our democracy. But tonight in DC, where I'm located, federal police used munitions on peaceful protesters half an hour before the city's curfew was scheduled to start. This reading festival is available to stream for no charge, but in lieu of any sort of tickets or even donations to Brave Spirits right now, we ask you to consider making a donation to your local social justice organization or bail fund. Washington, D.C. does not have cash bail, but Black Lives Matter D.C. does have a legal support fund, and we will be posting the link in the comments so that you can find that. Thank you for your time.